First, I'd like to say how much I appreciate you all hanging in with me over all these years that have gone by in telling the real story. You know, when I started this journey, a lot of people didn't believe a word I had to say. Now, a good number of people are looking at it and saying, hey, there's something to this story. And why is that? Well, it's because there are a lot of historians. Many of them right there in McNary County who over the years have talked about Buford Pusser and Walking Tall. The thing is, they don't always tell you the entire story, the whole story. They don't always tell you the truth. Think about this for a moment. How many others have you ever heard say that Buford took payoffs, that he was a bully? That he was a womanizer. I haven't heard it. They don't talk about it. Now, that is omission, and omission does not make a story true. There's a lot of things that I have uncovered that have dispelled a lot of the stories that are part of the legend. And why historians won't talk about it, I don't know. Now, I will say that there's been people that have joined the page that have told me that, hey, I went over and I talked to so and so, who's a historian over there. And they told me that if you had said these things back when Buford was alive, that he would have just beat the crap out of you for it. Well, probably if he was still alive, I would probably have been saying the same things I am now. My question to all these historians is, Buford's been gone for a long time. Why aren't you speaking up now? There's nothing for you to be afraid of. He's gone. He's dead. Deal with it. Tell the truth. Don't make omissions. Don't try to reinvent and reconstruct history. It's out there for you to find. I found it, so can you. You probably know about it and just aren't willing to talk about it. But you think about all the books that have been written, all the movies that have been made, the DVDs that have come out, and nobody has told the entire story, as far as I can tell, except for me trying it. And I've done it with documentation and witness interviews that back up what I have to say. All these stories about how Buford cleaned up the state line, what backs that up? Somebody tell me, please, what clubs that Buford shut down, what beer joints that Buford shut down, what state liners he sent to prison. Just explain to me what he did to clean up the state line. Now, having said that, let me go on. I'm going to be playing a video here in just a moment. And that video was, I felt like a very good video, actually. You know, there was a lot of praise for Buford, which, granted, he deserves some. I can't think of another person who inspired more people to get in law enforcement than Buford Pusser. But just because of that, he shouldn't get a free ride on the bad things he did. Guys, it's just time to tell the truth. Tell it like it is. Let it get out there. Let the people absorb it. They'll get over it. But, you know, to keep revising history is not the answer. But in this video, you're going to see a ceremony that was very respectfully done. They mentioned a lot of the good that Buford did. To me, they missed a great opportunity to present some of his issues. And by that, I mean, well, think about this. Think about what would have happened in this video when you've gone through it and you've seen it all. If at the end of it, they'd have said, you know, you don't want to necessarily be like Buford was. He was killed as a result of drinking and driving. Think of how many lives that could save. if they just came out and said, "Don't be like Buford, don't drink and drive." If he were here today, he'd probably tell you the same thing, but he's not here. Why? Because he killed himself in a drunk driving accident. It's that simple. The truth is that simple. I know it's hard for all these people who love the legend to say, "No, wait a minute, that's going too far." But is it? Think about how many marriages have been broken up by one partner or the other philandering around and getting into situations that wreck their marriage. And don't get me wrong, Pauline was not perfect. I know that. But at the same time, I found a lot of women that were with Buford. So don't put him up there on a pedestal so high that he can't be touched. Anyway, we'll get on to the video and we'll cover a couple of things after that. Be sure and subscribe and hit that bell so that you'll get notifications of new videos when they're released.
You may be wondering why we didn't do a lot bigger ceremony here today, being the 50th. And I'm going to tell you. Right before the 40th anniversary, 10 years ago, Sherry received a call from Dawana, Sheriff Pusser's daughter. And it was early in the morning. I was getting ready for work. And I could tell they were having a nice conversation. And I could tell it was about the 40th anniversary of Pusser's death. And evidently I was terribly frazzled and worn out, because normally I'm all for promoting this story. Always have been, anything I can do. So Sherry says, "Well, I'll talk to Steve." And she said, "If we do it, we're gonna do it big." And so she hung up with Dawana. And any of you that know my wife, Sherry, you know that she's the sweetest person you ever met, but she's as tough as she needs to be. So she walks up to me, sweet as she could be, and she said, "Well, that was Dawana," and said she's wanting to know if we want to do a 40th anniversary of her dad's death ceremony. And I turned around and looked at her. I said, "Look here, the man is dead. He's in the ground. We're all going to die. Let him rest in peace." And I said, "Besides, it's only been 40 years. I said, we may do something the 50th. She got in my face with her teeth gritted. And she said, "Do you have any idea how many of us might not be here for a 50th? Well, I dropped my head and turned it sideways, and I studied about 5 seconds, and I said, "Let's do a 40th. So we had all the past sheriffs there. At that point, Sherry came up with this idea also. She said, "How many past sheriffs have we got still living?" I said, "Well, there's 7 sheriffs. It would be wonderful if we could get all of them there," she said. I said, "Now that won't happen." And she said, "It won't if you don't ask." So I got to thinking how neat that would be to have all those sheriffs here. And we got it done. We had a big tent over here. We had water, we had a senator here, and we had a police car procession from the fairgrounds where Pusser left from and drove to right here. We had 16 squad cars led by the old walk and tall car that I built 22 years ago to promote this story. And it was a big day. This whole area was covered up with people. But it was a wonderful thing, and I told those sheriffs to do that for history's sake, you know, to be here, and they did. 10 years later, Dawana's dead. Atoye, her oldest daughter, just passed away Three of those sheriffs that we had here that day are gone. Billy Wagner, classmate to Buford, that was here that day, and the county historian, he's gone. Jack Kaufman, good close friend to Buford, he's gone. And Larry Price, I don't know if a lot of you remember Larry Price. Larry was here. He's gone. Larry was the last man. I jokingly tell people, when Pusser was at the fair that night, they had to be like 12,000 people at the McNair County Fair, because that's about how many have told me they were the last person to talk to Buford Pusser. But Larry Price was the last person to speak to Buford Pusser. And he drove 8 miles from the fairgrounds to his death right here. So, as I tell people, Dawana was the hub to this story for so many years. And there were a lot of spokes, but she was the hub. And when we were thinking about a 50th, I told Sherry, I said, we've already had the 50th. We've done had it. She called Sherry that next day and told her, she said, I want y'all to know how much that meant. And Sherry said, well, Dawana, we were glad to do it. You know, we always are glad to do anything to promote the story and your dad. She said, no, you're not understanding. You don't understand what that meant to me. She said, when Dad died, of course, he died in her arms right here, 13 years old. She said, I was a small young girl. I was devastated and in shock. And she said, people were making over my grandmother. And she said, I felt alone. And I didn't know what was going on. I didn't know those people that were there for the funeral. And she said, what y'all have done, you have given me my daddy's funeral. That was 10 years ago. Thank goodness we did. The day of Pusser's death, a lot of people get the story wrong. The first Walking Tall was released in early 73, and Buford Pusser was the biggest man in America. And it was decided that he would portray himself in the next movie titled Buford. They had the press release that day in Memphis. He drove his silver Lincoln to Memphis, the one that's in his car garage at his home. But when he got home, and this is how grounded Pusser was, he took the push mower and mowed his yard. He washed that Corvette, took the T-tops off and propped them against the fence there to dry. I've got those T-tops. He took a shower, told his mother he's gonna ride over to the fair. And he went to the fair, because Dawana was there. She didn't know he was coming. They rode rides, won teddy bears for her. They had a wonderful night. They walked up that ramp out of the fairgrounds and went through that ticket booth there at the gate. And a lot of people think that, like the movie showed, that Pusser's car was way off in the darkness. Nobody tampered with his car. It was 3 car widths from that gate. The three of them got in the car. Buford told them, standing there, all of them, if that green Monte Carlo gets here in a few minutes, tell them that the girls have rode home with me. They said, we'll do it. So they're about to leave, and Larry Price walks up to the driver's door of that Corvette and begins talking to Buford about coming to a motocross race that Sunday to sign autographs. And at that same instant, the green Monte Carlo pulled up. Those two little girls got out of the right front seat of that Corvette, told Buford, I love you, Daddy, I'll see you at home. They got in the green Monte Carlo and they left first. Buford talked 1 to 2 more minutes to Larry Price, and then he left. Kind of ironic again, but the one I told me one day standing in front of my shop, she said, "Do you know where my daddy passed us?" And I said, "No, I never did know." She said, "Right here in front of your shop." He was driving like he always did, extremely fast. Duana said, "Look at my daddy show out." Shirley Durbin in the front seat, she said, "Lord, I hope he don't get killed between here and home." And little Duana said, "Miss Shirley, please don't even say that." They drive 6 miles. It took them roughly 3 minutes. They were 3 to 4 minutes behind Buford. And when they got here, the Corvette had slammed into the embankment that used to be way on over. And it tossed Buford out, breaking his neck. Buford bought that Corvette in Alabama less than a year earlier. And that's the burned license plate off of it. I tell people that it tossed three things out of that Corvette that night. And this is kind of strange. It tossed Buford Pusser's body out, a pistol, and this Bible. This Bible's dated on the inside. His mother gave it to him May the 6th of 72. And I tell people, that young man had a lot going on May of 72. He was running for sheriff again in a heated sheriff's race, and they were about to start the movie, Walking Tall. He had a lot on his plate, but he carried that Bible on the dash of that Corvette until the night he died. That day, they had the press release in Memphis that he would portray himself in the next movie. Can you imagine how that young 36-year-old guy felt? New Lincoln, new Corvette, 36 years old, on top of the world, and about to become a movie star, to make his own movie. But I tell people, Buford Pusser's plans and his life ended right here at midnight that night. That young 36-year-old former sheriff died right here. 50 years ago at midnight last night. It was a lot of people get confused about the date, but he was actually dead on Tuesday night, August the 20th. You may not have known this guy, but dispatch sent police officer W.T. Yarmer by the hospital to get Dr. Peeler. And Dr. Peeler came right here to the crash site. And first, you know, checked out Buford. And then he was transported to the hospital and was pronounced dead. But that's how that happened. Sheriff, would you place this wreath and we'll conclude this ceremony in a minute. Stand here by me 1 second, Sheriff. I noticed a mistake on this sign. It says made him a nationally known hero. And the sheriff's got something to say about that.
So I've told this story several times, and I'm not the storyteller that Steve is, and I apologize. But in 2006, I had left McNary County, and I was working for the U.S. State Department in Afghanistan as a police trainer. And I had the opportunity to go to Dubai to speak at an international policing conference. And when they introduced me, there was not a big fanfare about who I was. It was Guy Buck, former deputy from McNary County, Tennessee. And I don't even remember what I spoke about. I really don't. But at the end of it, I didn't think anything about it, but I come off the stage and I probably had at least 10 people who didn't even speak English come up and go, "Buford Pusser," or another accent that I probably wouldn't do a very good job saying, but specifically a little Japanese guy. And it just struck me that, you know, here I am, you know, had worked right here in McNary County, and there was a, whether you love Buford or you hated Buford, the one thing that I've always said was that he influenced good people to do good things. What I mean by that is he influenced people my age and maybe a little bit older to get into this career field. We don't have that anymore. We don't have that role model out there anymore that we did when I was a child. And I couldn't tell you how many people that are my age or older that were motivated into this career field because of him for the right reasons.
That's right.
And if he did nothing else, that's a very positive thing that Buford Buster did.
That's
right. So he is definitely internationally known.
That's right.
Thing will blow over there. Looks good.
Good job. Appreciate you. As I said before, we've already had the 50th. We had it 10 years ago. Is anything anybody would like to say that's here today, anything of importance that you'd like to be known? If not, as far as I'm concerned, that concludes this ceremony. We thank you all for being here on the behalf of the Pusser family and Sherry and myself. Thank you.
Like I said earlier, I think Steve did a good job with this. I think it's great that he brought attention to the fact that it's been 50 years since Buford was killed. I think the ceremony was very respectful. My only problem is I wish that everybody involved in projects like this would just get in the habit of telling the entire story, not just the good parts. Now, he made a point that Duwana was the hub of keeping the Pusser legend alive. Well, I hate to burst a lot of people's bubbles, but Duwana really didn't know Buford. I doubt that she knew that he played around on her mom. I doubt that she realized that he took payoffs. And I'm sure she believed that he actually cleaned up the state line. But we know that that's not true. I mean, I have asked time and time again to name a state line establishment that he shut down or a state liner that he sent to prison, and nobody can give any word on that. Nobody seems to know what he actually did, but he gets credit for it. I don't know why. Now, historians that I've listened to didn't know Buford that well, if at all. You know, mostly what they know is stories that they have heard and what they saw in the movies. You know, he said that he thought that every person there claimed to be the last person to speak to Buford. And we know that can't be true. So, you know, there's a lot of stories that I hear that I know are not true. And I just kind of put them to the side because there's no use in listening to those. I've studied enough this story to know a lot of times when somebody's just wanting to include themselves in the bigger picture. Now, I know that a lot of people think what I'm doing is wrong and that it's going to have some kind of impact on McNary County and the tourism there. I don't think so. I couldn't help but notice that whenever Pauline was exhumed, and this was back in February, they posted about how they had such a busy time right after that. That is probably true. It rekindled interest in the story. Now, I've tried to tell different people in McNary County what they need to do is remarket this story as a Wyatt Earp type story, because Buford did a lot of good things, but he also did a lot of bad things. So his story and that of Wyatt Earp parallel each other in that regard. Now, to the historians that are out there that see this video, I would just like to say, again, don't try to reconstruct the legend. Don't try to revise it. Don't omit stories that you know are true. And if you don't know if they're true, do as I have and do some research. And stop telling a false legend. He didn't clean up the state line. He wasn't a great deal unlike most other sheriffs of that day. And granted, standards are different today than they were back then. So, you know, we can't hardly hold him to the level that we would today. However, I will say that had he tried some of those tactics in today's world, he wouldn't have been a sheriff very long. He would have lost his job. So I will say that I don't believe that the Pusser legend, as it's being told, is true. Walking Tall was not a true movie. They put in the captions that it was based upon certain events in the sheriff's life and that it was fictionalized. But a lot of people don't get that. They look at it and they think it's a true story because of the way that it was marketed. Now, again, Buford did a lot of good things in his life. You know, as I said, he probably got more people involved in law enforcement than any other person I can think of. Can I say that he positively killed Pauline? No, I can't. What I can tell you, though, is that I can look at the evidence and say that investigators back then somehow overlooked the number one suspect that they should have been looking at, the prime suspect. The evidence speaks for itself. Take a look at it. See what you think. But don't ignore it. Don't act like it's wrong. I mean, what were there? Seven different people that were involved prior to Pauline's death that thought something was suspicious about his activities during those last few hours? At any rate, I'll get off here again to the historians. Stop omitting the truth. Just tell the whole story. That's what people really want. Until next time, just remember, the truth has no agenda.